Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back. This is John with Behind the Reel. We are working on season two. This is episode number 9. We've got a returning guest, Mr. Brennan Banks, and we're going to be talking about his most recent win on Lake of the Ozarks. And this was with the Anglers in Action series. He's got some upcoming tournaments with that series coming up. But he's got a nice win already on the belt for the year. So some really good points and some prize money, which he has admitted is probably all going back to the boat. But, you know, we're all kind of addicted. I think that's a fair word to use. We've all gotten pretty ate up with all this fishing stuff. And even a guy who probably has everything you could ever imagine, somebody who works full time in the fishing industry, has, you know, all these awesome swim baits, has all these awesome baits and all this technology. There's always something that we're looking to add to our arsenal, looking to add to the boat, just to have that little slight advantage. But, you know, the whole premise behind this podcast is learning, you know, what's going on, not necessarily behind all the gadgets, behind all the tackle, but what's going on behind the reel, right? What's going on in the person's mind, right? And that's where I think that a lot of these wins really come from. Not necessarily what baits are being thrown, not necessarily what spots are being fished all the time, but, you know, what goes on in between your ears. So we're going to get with Brennan here in just a minute, and we're going to get right to it. If you guys have any questions at all, make sure you put them over there in the comment section over to the side here of the screen, and we will get to those here pretty quickly. We've got kind of some questions that we'll ask already kind of on the table here. But if you guys have some specific questions that you're interested in hearing about, we'll get to those as well. And if you guys could do me a favor, share this video with some friends, share it in a local fishing group, share it with people that you think might enjoy it. You know, we've all got fishing buddies, and Brennan is a pretty popular fella in the Ozarks, in the swim bait community, just in the fishing community all around. So I'm sure lots of people will be on here later on listening to this. But if you want to be involved, or if you think your buddies might be involved, go ahead and share this with a buddy for me. So we're going to go ahead. We're going to get to it. I do want to shout out one of our sponsors. That is Biz Baits. If you guys are interested in getting some soft plastics, they do have some terminal tackle and some hard baits as well. Some jigs and spinner baits and stuff like that. Go over to bizbaits.com. If you're interested in placing an order, shoot me a message and I just might have a pretty sweet little promo code for you. This is the Cutter Craw. They have released this in a small version and they're calling it the Baby Cutter Craw, but it's a really awesome bait that's going to give you lots of action. I guess you could compare it to like a speed craw. So awesome for just a Texas rig, back on a jig, swim jig, chatterbait, something like that. But anyways, they've got a little mini version that might do well on a Ned rig down there on those Ozarks lakes. So if any of you guys are interested, make sure you go check those guys out. But we're going to go ahead and we are going to bring Brennan on. And again, if you guys have any questions or anything, just put that over there in the comment section and we'll get right to them. What's up, man?
What's going on?
How you doing this evening?
Pretty good. How about yourself?
Not too bad. Just got fishing on my mind like always.
Yep. Yep. That's it.
Is that a problem you face as well?
It's yep. Big one.
How does that happen? So you have been pretty big into fishing for, you know, you share these like Facebook memories and stuff like that for a long time, and you're fully immersed in the industry at this point. I mean, what part of your life does not involve fishing at this point?
not really any of it besides, you know, family, but that's about all I do. I don't really have any other hobbies or anything else I do. So that's it.
Yeah. That's all cool. And so we have had you on here before, so I'm sure we've had a little bit of backstory, but like, where did fishing start for you? And then where did, or when did maybe it really hit you that this is something that, you know, you're going to take to the next level like you have?
Yeah. Yeah. I just started, you know, bluegill fishing in the local river and stuff like that. I remember catching my first bass out there, Finley River in Ozark, but that's all I've really ever wanted to do since I can remember, you know. I didn't really have anyone that taught it to me or anything like that until I was a little bit older.
Yeah.
But then I had a real good buddy, Timmy, that I met through just kind of like a local tackle shop, and he got me into a bass club, and that's where I got introduced to tournament fishing. So started that when I was about 14 is when I started kind of dipping into tournament fishing a little bit. Okay. And pretty quickly, I think my first year fishing in that bass club, I won the whole club for the year by like 10 pounds or something from the back of their boats. And after that, I think it was my senior year in high school was the first year that Missouri had high school bass fishing, and won a pretty big tournament doing that, like 180 boats or something, won it by a couple pounds. And, you know, just went on from there.
Yeah. Okay. And so for those that don't know, you have what, within the last year or two, started working for Boatworks?
Yep, been there a little over 2 years now.
Wow. Time flies, man.
Yes, it does.
And so you were like an electrician before?
Yep.
And then so kind of had an easy transition over into boat rigging.
Some of the same stuff anyways, but.
Yeah. Probably a little bit more tolerable when your workspace is filled with fish finders and tackle
a little bit more fun.
Yeah, definitely easy to be more passionate about, you know, that. So it's you go to work every day and you've got a bass boat in your office. That's not a bad day at work.
Yep, a little bit more fun.
Now, okay, so for those that may be, you know, trying to crack the Lake of the Ozarks code, I know you're probably going to keep all the secrets to yourself as far as, you know, all the waypoints and everything, but like for somebody maybe that is new to fishing or maybe new to fishing that lake, how does it differ or does it from some of the other fisheries in the area?
Well, to be honest, I usually only fish that lake twice a year for the Big Bass Bash 2-day tournament in the spring and a 2-day tournament in the fall. That's usually all I fish it. Hmm. But ended up having an OMTT the day before that my buddy and I went and fished and went to a new part of the lake and found some fish. So went back with Anglers in Action to try and catch some of those fish, and that worked out. But fish is a lot shallower, you know, obviously tons of docks, tons of big boats. A little bit more stained water, just comparing it to like Table Rock and Bull Shoals and stuff.
Yeah.
Just a real developed lake. I'm by no means any expert out there, but it tends to just fish a lot shallower than the rest of the lakes around here year round. A lot of current flow through it. But that's most of the lakes around here.
Yeah.
It's big, but, just go fish and, you know, find a small part of the lake that you like and just fish that section as a lake within it, you know, within a lake, and just break that area down. There's, you know, several different areas of the lake where you can spend weeks just fishing that one little area, you know.
Yeah, and so I guess on a lake that size, do you – like if you're fishing that area of the lake for weeks at a time, are you fishing for the same fish? Do they generally stay in that part of the lake or?
I would think so. You know, they've got a small range, you know, there's, you know, several big arms to the lake and, you know, I'm sure those fish don't go more than, you know, a mile or so within their range. So, you know, I'm sure you are fishing for the same fish, but you're never going to wear them out, you know, yourself.
Now, when you say you found fish the day before, is that are you seeing these fish on electronics? I'm assuming you caught some of them.
Did you? Yeah, we like I said, we fished the Ozark Mountain Team Trail the day before, and I hadn't fished the lake in about a month or so. Cole and I fished a little bitty deal up there, but we didn't learn anything. Usually I've got a small part of the lake and I only fish that part of the lake. But during the OMTT on Saturday, before the anglers in action, we tried a spot kind of close to the put in for about the first 2 or 3 hours and didn't see much going on there. So Cole and I had fished the other direction a few weeks prior and we didn't do well. We didn't see a lot of fish, not much happened. So we went the other way and I'd never even been that way. And we just went till we found something good. And we caught a limit there and ended up placing, I think, 18th in the OMTT. But I mean, I'd never even been in that area before, rolled up in there and saw some big fish follow. Saw some big fish blow out my bait, caught some decent fish, and they were just eating the jerk bait well. We just didn't hook up with any big ones. There was no wind or anything like that. It was pretty flat and sunny, so the fish weren't committing super well. But I just saw a lot of big fish following on live scope and things like that, big fish around brush piles that wouldn't commit completely. So we come back the next day, and we had a lot of wind, and they ate really well.
Okay. And as far as live scope goes, like how has that played a factor in the way you fish versus before, you know, you had that technology?
Mm-hmm. I mean, basically what I was doing was just panning around looking for brush piles or concrete or any sort of cover in the water and just fishing that, whether I see a fish on it or not. It wasn't necessarily targeting individual fish, mm-hmm. More just targeting the cover. And they were pretty deep in it or locked onto it pretty close. So, I mean, a couple of the fish that I caught were, you know, we were way off the docks and I'd pan out way out deep and see one. You know, there's a lot of drum and stuff out there, but after you spend enough time with it, you can tell what's a bass and what's a drum or a carp way out there. And a few of those good fish come from just 4 or 5 feet down in the 20, 25 foot of water just sitting out there. So you definitely wouldn't catch those fish without it. But just makes it a lot more efficient finding brush and cover and stuff like that. And that's basically all we were doing.
So you're not necessarily locking onto that fish, targeting that fish. And
I mean, sometimes,
some
yeah.
Of, some
I mean,
of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely a good part of it's that. But the main deal was just finding the cover and staying way out from it, putting my range on like 100, 110 foot to where you can't see a specific fish super great detail. But yeah. you can tell what you're looking at. You can tell if it's brush or whatever else, and just staying far away from it, making a good cast over the right kind of cover.
And then just seeing fish or bait in the area probably keeps you there even longer. You know, like you just may not be
what's going on around you, mm-hmm. even if you're not, like I said, targeting specific fish. So,
and then if you stop seeing that fish activity, you may go look for another. Now you said something about 110 feet away. So like, are you noticing that there's a little bit more pressure maybe from this technology? Oh, yeah. Are you having to back off of them more than you did in the past?
I think so. Yeah. I think that's a big player is being able to notice what you're looking at, notice the fish or the cover. You know, way out there. Some people run their forward range on 60, 70, 80 foot. And so that means by the time, you know, you're set up on that fish is only 40 feet away from you, you know, and he's hearing the trolling motor, he's hearing the boat, he can tell your presence, hearing the transducer or whatever else. So I think being able to recognize what you're looking at and stay farther back from him than most people, I think is a big key.
Yeah.
And that just gives you more distance in between where your bait lands and yourself, you know, it's more time to, you know, if a fish is following, it's more time to be able to make it react because sometimes they'll follow forever, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think that helps a lot too. Instead of, you know, that fish getting hot on your bait at 30 foot out and then all of a sudden you run out of room right when he's about to eat.
Yeah.
You've got a lot more room to play with.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. And now what about a jerkbait? Like, has that been a long time go-to for you?
I fished one for quite a while. I mean, it's always been a bait I threw and done well on. definitely fish it different now with live scope, but doing pretty much the same stuff.
Curious, what has changed? Like, have you changed up your cadence? Have you done anything different
I hardly pause my jerkbait, you know, more than 3 or 4 seconds.
Okay.
You're just able to read their body language. And most of the time you see that they don't want a long pause. Every once in a while, you see a big fish in a brush pile, I'll, you know, bring it over the top. And if she doesn't shoot out and eat it, then you can sit there and soak it for a little while. And then she'll slowly come out of there. And then you can start kind of giving it a little bit more cadence and she'll start firing up on it. But other than that, I mean, I'm not doing anything special with it. I'm just kind of reading their body language and putting it where it needs to be.
Yeah. So like, I guess Lake of the Ozarks, like you said, is a little bit dirtier. Like, what was the water visibility the day of the tournament, roughly?
It was like 3 to 4 foot. It wasn't dirty by any means, but not.
Yeah.
It was good. Good jerkbait water.
Now, you said you don't pause it more than maybe 3 or 4 seconds. Are you still going to do that when you have 6 or 7 foot of visibility on table rock? I mean,
I've never given it long pauses or anything. You know, I'm more so looking for active fish with it, I guess you could say. But, you know, with live scope, sometimes you can tell if a fish isn't super hot on it but interested. Sometimes you'll sit there and leave it and give her time to catch up to it. And, you know, sometimes I want a little bit slower. But
now, what did this day look like for you? Did you get out there and start swinging on them pretty early, or?
Yeah, I think I caught like a 5 1/4 in the first probably 30 or 45 minutes off. Wow. I think the first spot we pulled up to, and pretty much caught fish all day long. Caught a 5 1/4 in the first hour, and then caught some real good quality 3 to 4 pound fish in between. Then I caught one almost 6. I forget what it was, probably around 1 o'clock. And we knew we had a big bag. We were doing it like 4. So we actually ran back at about 2:30 because we had a fairly decent run and it was pretty windy and choppy. So I wanted to make sure we had time to get the fish back without beating the crap out of them. And so we ended up fishing an area right there by the way, and not right, but you know, a couple miles from it, close enough to it, and ended up culling out like a 3.5 pounder with a 4 pounder. Just stopped on a random point, caught a good one there, and then they pretty much bit from morning to the end. Caught quality fish all day.
What from like a tackle perspective, do you do anything different with a jerk bait or like with the rod or reel or anything, or?
No. Pretty standard. Just fish 10 pound floor on Lake of the Ozarks, you know, around 70 head or so. Sometimes I'll even fish 12, but usually 10 pound floor. And I think it's important to upgrade your hooks on most stuff. I use the Gamakatsu, the Aaron Martin G Finesse. I like those a ton for a jerkbait. Either that or just regular Gammy round guns. But other than that, nothing special. I'm using that new F5, the 6.9 bait caster. It's an awesome jerkbait rod. I never lost a fish all day, and I think that helped a ton.
So, yeah, talking about F5, there's been a lot of success with F5 rods here lately. Mm-hmm. And have been for a long time. But something that I didn't realize, and maybe he's been making all, you know, conventional rods, but I knew him more for swim bait, big swim bait stuff. Is the conventional lineup something new? And I know they kind of like changed up their name maybe to target more conventional.
Yeah, I mean, that's where the market is. You know, I feel like 95% of people that want to swim bait fish hard, they've got the rods they want. You know, they've invested in them. It's just a bigger market, I think. And Brad knows how to build a quality rod. There's no reason he should just stick to swim bait rods, you know. So he's expanded, and I think he's had the Ghost Code tournament series out for about 6 months now, and it's super solid. I fished that setup down in Mexico, and it did awesome. And I mean, I think he's working on a couple other models to add to it. Don't mark my words, but I think he's got 7 rods right now that pretty much cover most of your typical stuff. I think he's trying to add a couple specialty rods in there too as well. But
tell us about Mexico. I know you've been a few times, haven't you?
Just twice now.
Twice. What's that like?
It's a blast. They take awesome care of you. I stay with Chad at Back Rack Lodge, and they're awesome. They take really good care of you, and you catch a bunch of fish. It's a lot of fun. I recommend it to anyone. There might be better places in the States to go target, 13 pounders, but just for overall the best fishing you can experience, that place has it.
Who did you go down there with? Peyton? Was that last year?
No, Peyton wasn't able to make it. I went with Patrick Reese the first year that I went, and then went with my buddy Joe Notham this past year and a couple other guys. So,
okay. Heck yeah. Yeah, that's definitely on the bucket list.
Looking to do the Colombia trip probably next year to go chase the peacocks. I might skip Mexico this year and do Colombia next year.
That would be cool. Heck yeah. What kind of did you catch some double digits while you were down there?
I caught one double digit. I think one or two nines the first trip. Second trip, didn't catch any big ones. Caught a lot of sixes. I think a couple around seven, but it was all on a popper, so it was a lot of fun. We caught a bunch of fish. It was good fishing. There's no giants. So we showed up just a little bit early. The few weeks after we left, there was numerous big fish caught. So it's a real big timing deal down there, but the fishing's almost always good. So but it was a really fun bite. We were throwing just little it's actually one of the baits I fished, just a little yellow magic popper, and they were swallowing it. It was fun. Throwing it up in the bushes in high water.
Very fun. Cool. Heck yeah. Yeah, is that like a little bit of a confidence booster? Like, do you go down there and try out new baits, or?
Believe it or not, those fish are actually really, really specific on what they want to eat.
Really?
You would think otherwise. They don't get a lot of pressure, but they're actually really, really specific. Like, they only want a specific kind of popper in a specific place, and once you figure that out, it's awesome. And, like, the year before I went in the spring, water was way low. And they only wanted a certain kind of spinnerbait. They wanted a big 1 ounce spinnerbait, and anything else wasn't getting any quality bites. Mm-hmm. And like you could throw, a little swim bait or anything else through a bunch of fish, and they wouldn't touch it. And then you could go throw an underspin or the right spinnerbait through them, and you'd catch five of them. It was weird. They get real specific down there, believe it or not. But you can learn some different stuff that we definitely don't do back home a lot.
Did you take any of it back home and use it here?
A little bit, yeah. Nothing that stands out, but yeah, it definitely gives you a little bit different perspective.
And, I'm sure there's some pretty sophisticated lodges and stuff like that down there, but it seems like when I see pictures, a lot of the times they have kind of outdated technology a lot of times. So, like, are you fishing live scope down there, or?
No, it's just 16, 17 foot V bottom boats, tiller handle, and they've got a spot lock Taroba on them, or power drive, or whatever. Yeah. But no graphs. I mean, some of the guys use a graph just for depth in the back. But no, you're not. You're fishing blind completely. Just fishing the spots that the guys have fished or known forever. So it's a cool deal though. But, at the same time, if you want to go try something different, if you have a spot you want to go try or technique, then they don't mind doing that either.
Yeah, that's cool.
But it's kind of fun to not have to worry about electronics or anything like that and just go fishing. It's a lot of fun.
Yes, it's a little bit different than what you have to do to compete nowadays.
Yep, it's fun.
And did you kind of always embrace the technology, or did you get to a point where you're like, man, I'm going to have to start messing with this stuff?
Like when I was younger, my first kayak that I got at Academy for $250, I, put a graph on it.
Yeah.
And I was 13 or 14 years old, and
sure,
always put little graphs on my kayaks whenever I got them and stuff like that. But as I progressed, I went from kayak to a tracker and then to an Avid. Now I'm in a Skeeter, but I had put live scope on the tracker just about right when it came out, and obviously had a pretty good setup on the Avid. and I got the skeeter set up how I want. So I've been playing, you know, I've used it as long as it's been popular.
Yeah.
But, you know, most of my kayak fishing, I wasn't doing anything special with electronics besides depth. And that's, you know, that's my route. Mostly just blind fishing kayaks. And a lot of the tournament fishing, you know, whenever I first got into it, you know, I was fishing out of an old Ranger and, you know, just had 2D. We didn't use it for anything really. So just fishing instinctually.
Yeah. Heck yeah. Let's see here. Okay, so you're in a skeeter now. Yeah, you were in an Avid last time. I think that was fairly new when you were on the show the last time. Uh-huh. How do you compare the Avid to the skeeter? What are some of the maybe the pros and cons there?
Well, I went from an 18-foot Avid aluminum boat to a 21-foot skeeter. And, you know, the Avid was a really awesome boat for me. It was solid, and I liked that I could, you know, drop it in little spots and single axle trailer. But it was still wide. It still felt like a big boat, like it was had a 97-inch beam or something on it. It was really wide, really, really solid fishing platform for its size. It was a good boat for me. But, you know, it obviously didn't handle big water like a big glass boat's going to, you know. And that's something that I felt like I kind of needed at this point. To fish these bigger tournaments and stuff and make longer runs. So,
yeah,
it was a really good boat for me, but the skeeter definitely allows me to, you know, make longer runs and fish bigger water, compete a little bit more. So,
and like, bigger fuel tanks, is that what you mean by longer runs, faster?
You know, that Avid, yeah, it only had a 115 on it, so it had 20-gallon tank in it. The skeeter's got a 250 on it, but bigger tank, so it's got about the same range, but get there faster, get there without beating you up too bad if it's real rough.
Yeah,
especially, yeah, sure. Especially get you back without beating the fish up as bad, you know. You get bouncing around like crazy and slosh all the water out of your live well, and that can happen.
Edwin's on here. He says he heard you were good at fishing Ned rigs.
He might be saying that as a joke, but I love a Ned rig. It gets big. I don't throw it much, but
yeah,
you know, at the right time, it'll get a big bite.
Okay. What's your go-to Ned rig setup?
I don't have a setup. I just throw a Ned rig on 7-pound fluoro or something and whatever.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah.
Big ones will eat it. I've caught some, you know, low 4-pound smallmouth on it, and a couple, you know, mid 5-pound largemouth on it. But it gets bit. It's fun to throw in like the spring and stuff, and you can go catch 100 fish on it, and some of them can be a real good fish. So I'll throw whatever they want. I caught a 7-3 on Table Rock the other day, and that was my biggest Table Rock fish ever, actually. And I caught it on a little, you know, little paddle tail.
Really? Okay. What, you gonna give away any juice on that one, like bait or jig head or?
Yeah, I was just fishing a little true bass swim bait on a tungsten head.
Okay.
Tungsten head fishing under shad balls and stuff.
Okay. And let's see, you have a Table Rock event coming up for Anglers in Action. Are you always like, how often are you fishing? Like is Table Rock your home lake?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I can be there in 45 minutes and that's where I've definitely spent most of my time. So yeah.
Are you there a few times a week? Are you fishing after work type stuff?
You know, I'm there probably a couple times a month. You know, I don't fish it a ton. You know, after work, now that daylight savings is hit, I'll start fishing a little bit more after work in the summertime. But, no, I don't fish it. You know, I've fished it a ton, but I don't fish it, you know, every week or anything like that. We've got too much water around here I can go anywhere.
Yeah. He says he's heard there's a tournament at Big Hill this weekend. Yeah. If you guys are interested in taking a part of that tournament, that is a USA Bassin event, kind of a cool little local deal that they're doing this year. Jacob Ward's heading that up. There's going to be one on Saturday at Big Hill, Sunday at El Dorado. I'm going to try to make the El Dorado event. I've got my mom coming into town. She's actually in Brennan's neck of the woods. My youngest daughter's hanging out with her for spring break. She's hanging out there in Ozark, Missouri for the week. And she will be coming back into town on Sunday. So I may or may not be able to fish that tournament. If it works out, I'm going to fish it. I won't be at the Big Hill one, but we've got a Kansas Kayak Anglers event coming up on April 8th on Big Hill Lake as well. So if you guys are looking to get some practice in, go check out the USA Bass and stuff. That's kind of a cool deal. I think there's like 7 or 8 tournaments throughout the year, all on one single body of water. So kind of a cool way if you don't have the ability or don't want to travel around and fish these bigger tournaments or bigger series, you can just kind of focus in on one body of water and still have a chance to win some money. Kind of cool.
Never fished there.
Yeah, it's a small little lake. You know, it'd probably be like shooting fish in a barrel for you, but Big Hill has been tough on me. I finally put together my first limit on Big Hill last year. I've just, every time I go there, I struggle. It's in Southeast Kansas. So probably not too far from you. We've had a couple tournaments out there that like Richie and some of those guys will come over and
right.
The Moyat guys, some of those guys will come fish with us in those events. But okay, we've got another guy here. Gonna stop in at both Big Hill and El Dorado. So yeah, heck yeah. Well, excited to have you guys joining us for the local kayak fishing tournament scene here in Kansas. I know Brennan kind of got his start kayak fishing, as he's mentioned briefly in this podcast here tonight. But he's just over there in like the Springfield area.
Yeah, Ozark, Nixa, Springfield, Branson. Yep.
It's kind of all the same thing now, ain't it?
Yep, pretty much. It's getting to be that way.
But, you know, another thing too that you see a lot more kayaks down there. A lot more water down there, I guess. Maybe that's part of it. But, you know, like the float trips, that's like, is that a big thing for like high school students or, you know? Oh, like,
yep. Everyone wants to go float and party all summer.
Yeah.
Not my deal, but yep, big deal around here. There's a lot of rivers.
Yeah. So, yeah, kayaks are just a little bit more common, you know, down there. But yep. A lot of people probably have kayaks that have never fished down there as well. But
yeah, exactly.
Over there, down there, I don't know. It's somewhere.
Yep. Over yonder.
Now, a lot of guys know you. So Edwin kind of made a joke about Ned Riggs there, you know, because you are well known for catching big fish on swim baits. Is that something that you are focusing on less now? Is it like a time of year deal? Like maybe go into that. Cause, yeah.
I mean, I fished them, from somewhere around 2016 to about 2020 strictly. I really didn't do much else.
Okay.
Before that I tournament fished. I know I'm obviously tournament fishing again, and I did a little bit during that period. But I pretty much just did swim bait fishing and learned it really well, caught a lot of fish on it, fished it year round, and learned when it worked and when it didn't work and just how to make it work. And as it's grown in this area, it kind of blew up pretty quick from, you know, in the last 2 years, as we kind of expected it to.
Thanks a lot, KGB.
it's become a lot more situational, like anything, you know, like when the Alabama rig come out, you could throw that thing anywhere and just catch 30 pounds on it around here. But, and that's kind of how the glide bait was. It wasn't quite the same scenario, but the fish hadn't seen it, and it caught big fish and drew big fish out because they had never seen anything like it. And it still has its place now for sure, but it's just a lot more situational, like anything else becomes, you know. You got to fish on the right day, on the right time of year. And you just got to do it a lot more correctly now, you know?
Yeah. And maybe,
maybe
the forward facing stuff will help you to be able to be more stealthy and.
Yeah, for sure. No, it glide baits or swim baits in general and forward facing sonar definitely works really well. A lot of people are hesitant about it, few years ago, but yeah, it's definitely a deal. You can put them over the top of rush piles and whatever else, and they eat it well. But no, the last few years I've got back into tournament fishing and started, you know, I didn't even have a conventional lineup while I was fishing swim baits. I don't think I had a spinning rod or any jerkbait rod or anything. And so I started stocking up back on all that stuff just to, you know, I've still got all my swim bait stuff. I've still got more swim bait rods than I do conventional rods, but.
Okay.
No, fishing a lot more conventional than I am swim baits now. I keep one around for the right time, but not throwing one like I used to.
What?
I think throwing swim baits all the time, you're missing out on the biggest bites. People say, you know, yes, at the right time, it will get the biggest bite, but you're going to miss out on a lot of big fish not throwing conventional stuff, especially around here, you know, and most places in the country, they're eating small bait most of the time. They're eating thread fins.
Yeah. Okay. Now, how do you decide, or I guess what made you decide to throw a jerkbait? Like, did you ever consider, like, this time of year, what played a part in you deciding not to throw swim baits, you know, in this tournament, or did you, and just not get the bites?
Well, I didn't even have one in the boat. I just know this time of year, especially out on Lake the Ozarks, it's like a one bite a day kind of deal. Once it warms up a little bit more, you can definitely catch a good limit on it. But, you know, when that water's still colder, especially in the spring, it's a one bite a day typically. It might be a big one, but the jerk bait can get that same bite, I think, this time of year. And you'd catch a bunch more on a jerk bait. I knew the fishing was going to be pretty tough. And water temp was like 45, something like that, 44. And that's just a lot more versatile bait than a swim bait in those conditions. So that's basically all I threw all day.
Okay. And I don't even think we even talked about it, but so you said you had like a six and or no, a five and a half. What did your limit look like? It was like 23 pounds.
Yeah, it was 23 flat. I had like a five and a quarter and then one up close to six. So I had two really nice fish and the rest were like heavy 3 to 4 pounders. And caught a few more heavy 3 to 4 pounders that ended up getting called out. So, I mean, we had had probably 12 keepers that day, so probably had another limit that we called out that was probably in that 17-pound range, 17, okay. 18 pounds. So, yeah, I mean, they bit. We caught them, and they were actually swallowing the whole jerkbait. I hadn't really got on a jerkbait bite that good before. I mean, I've got on some good jerkbait bites, but I think three or four of the fish that I caught that day had the whole thing. They'd come in and have their mouth shut, and you couldn't even see your bait. Like, they were swallowing it.
What makes them do that?
I don't know. I guess they just something. I don't know. They were hungry, or I worked it right, or something. I don't know.
Is it like they're being super aggressive? Like, is it a?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the presentation was just right, and I don't know. Something was right. I couldn't tell you what it was, but yeah. They liked what I was doing.
I had a couple fish eat my square bill like that this weekend, where it was like. Mm-hmm. It was just down in there. I mean, I stuck my hand in his mouth to grip him, and I wasn't touching my crankbait. It was way down in there. And
yeah. Like,
what is that? Is that
especially fishing forward facing sonar? That's even less frequent, just because I think they are more aware of your presence, and most of the time you're fishing closer to those fish, you can get a better picture on your screen, which you should try not to do. Try and still stay as far away as you would without it, but I think a lot of those fish end up not eating it as good, or they end up swiping at it or blowing it out and not getting hooks, or just getting the skin hooked. But I don't know, something we were doing was right. So
yeah. Were they pretty fat? Like, are they?
They were real healthy pre-spawn fish, and then had shad around. They were eating shad as well. So healthy fish.
Rut runners here. What type of pattern do you first look for this time of year when you're getting on a new body of water? What are some things that he can look for?
I mean, obviously this time of year you're looking for pre-spawn fish, you know, fish getting ready to spawn. So look for any of those spawning pockets and fish outside of those. Seems like this year pre-spawn, I do a lot better on the flatter stuff. in general, any flatter pea gravel banks or anything like that, anything just outside of those where they can stage up, any brush piles or points or anything like that, especially the ones that have bait around them, seems to be a good place to look. But no, I mean, just your typical pre-spawn areas this time of year. Every lake's different, obviously, but nothing specific that I look for in every lake, you know.
Do we seem to be kind of on track based on previous years with like water temps and where the fish are at in relation to the spawn?
Yeah, it seems like, though, you know, typically around here they spawn in late April. We'll think it happens a lot earlier than it really does, and some of it does. Some of it happens early. I mean, we get an early wave, but yeah, it seems like it's about on track. Most of our water is 45 to 50 right now. Some spots a little bit warmer in the dirtier water and up the rivers and stuff, but yeah, it seems about on track.
Yeah, that's about what we're seeing here too, as far as water temps go.
Mm-hmm. Getting a lot of rain. Some of the rivers and lakes dirtied up a little bit. I think we're supposed to get some more tomorrow. So it's all on track.
Not a bad thing. We definitely need it.
Yeah. Ain't going to hurt.
Okay. Jay says he's had many discussions about throwing glide baits during tournaments. Do you feel confident enough to throw one four or five fish tournament?
Yeah, absolutely. We've won multiple tournaments just throw glide baits. It definitely works. You just, like I said, a couple of years ago, before they had seen a lot, it might have happened more often that way. And now it's more situational, you know, say, you know, April, May, June, I'll throw one. You know, I wouldn't have a problem throwing one all day during a tournament, especially if you have a co-angler that's doing something different. It helps because, you know, glide bait fishing, you might get the bites, but they might not all come in the boat. Sometimes they do. Sometimes you can catch 50 fish on one in a day. But, you know, and in the fall, October, November, December, it can happen really well. But it's just more situational, I think. But, yeah, absolutely. You can, if you get on a good bite with it, you can definitely catch a limit or five limits a day on it, you know.
Yeah. What, just for the people that maybe don't know, what's the most money you've ever won in a tournament fishing a swim bait?
Well, Cole Anderson and I won the Big Bass Bash. We ended up with $103,000. He caught the big fish at the tournament, and I caught another first place hourly fish. And I think we went home with $103,000. So that was pretty cool. And I think we only had two fish in 2 days. He caught one, I caught the other, and that was it. That was day one. Wild. Pretty cool. And
that'll get you pretty ate up on big swim baits, won't it?
Yeah, and had some opportunities at least one other really big fish in that same class. And then Joe Montgomery and I won an Ozark Mountain Team Trail. It was a five-fish tournament. Well, it was actually a four-fish tournament because it was in August. But we won that with 16.5 pounds on four fish or something like that. And Peyton and I have done pretty well fishing local five-fish tournaments with glide baits. But it works.
Heck yeah. Okay, so what are some of the, like, you hear people talk about suspending jerk baits. You hear people talk about, you know, like baits like the Stunna that have kind of a sink to them. What do you find is the most effective, or maybe this time of year, or why do you pick one over the other?
From what I've seen, other people might disagree, but the fish aren't super tuned into whether it's sinking or floating. It's more to me about how you can present that bait. So during the tournament, I was fishing these two jerk baits. I had this Spro, had it slowly floating, real slow. I've even got some lead on it, but it was still slowly floating. And then I had the Mega Bass slowly sinking. So if I see a brush pile 12 foot down, I can throw this one and get it right over the top of it. But if I see a fish posted up in the top of a brush pile and that fish is 5-6 feet down, I can work this one, get it close to it, still throw it past the fish, and I can let it float up without going under that fish or hitting it and spooking it. I can still keep the bait, you know, in the right strike zone. So, you know, and a suspending jerk bait's just a good neutral bait to be throwing if you're just going to be throwing one, I think, you know. But I don't know. I throw all of them. I typically prefer a sinking jerkbait, especially with live scope. That way you can, you know, I throw one of the 6 cents on it. It sinks pretty dang fast. It gets down probably a foot every 2 to 3 seconds. So, like, if you see fish on live scope 15 foot deep, you can work it down and then let it sink the rest of the way down and get that bait in front of a fish that's down there further than most jerkbaits will go. And especially if they follow it to the boat, instead of just going up, you know, touching your jerkbait up, you can sink it back down and yank it and let it sink down and yank it. You can keep it right in their nose, which I've caught some good fish doing it that way.
Heck yeah. Yeah, I don't ever fish a jerkbait. I decided this year I was going to try to fish more of them. Maybe caught my first couple of fish on a jerkbait this year. I really don't recall ever fish like catching a fish on a jerkbait. I would imagine, you know, that I probably threw it out there a few times. You know, didn't have the results I was looking for, and I just put it away. I didn't really have the dedication to it. But
it's a versatile bait. You can, you know, most people, including myself, just throw them in the colder months. But, you know, especially like river fish and things like that, you can catch them all year round on a jerkbait. It's just a real versatile bait. It's awesome. Especially when the water's below 55, I like them a lot.
Yeah, and then like you said, you know, you hear people talk about throwing them all year long, and then, you know, maybe that's when you speed up that presentation, I would imagine. But
exactly. Even in the cold water, they want it fast and aggressive, you know.
Now, when you start maybe thinking about throwing more bigger baits, what are going to be your couple of go-tos as, you know, you start to see those conditions become more conducive?
Colder water, I really like the Negotiator. It works in the winter or early spring or late fall for me really well, just because I can tune it to suspend, and it's a real subtle action. I like it a ton, but, I mean, I throw a lot of the KGB stuff, especially the Chad, whenever they're real aggressive, and I can get super aggressive with that bait and not give them a super good look at it. But I throw all the KGB stuff pretty much, and I don't know, there's a million swim baits out there. There are a lot of soft baits, Huddlestons and Burritos and Magnums, whatever else. But, you know, the staples are the KGBs. I throw a lot of them. And Negotiator, like as far as hard baits go, those are my two hard baits that I like a lot. A lot of the bullshad stuff, I like it. But I keep it pretty simple with the swim baits. I used to have a ginormous collection of them and threw three of them. So I pretty much sold all that and stocked up on the stuff that I threw mostly. And now I've just got baits that only get thrown, and they all swim right, and I have confidence in all the baits that I own. I don't have anything really sitting around anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, that seems to be a big thing with the big swim bait guys, is, you know, a lot of them become collectors.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, I got that way just kind of – I had a lot of different baits, and just trying to figure out what worked for me and what I liked. And like I said, it took a few years, and then I, you know, started small and got big with them, and then I tapered it back off, and I've only got what works for me. So,
well, it makes sense to do that, right? Especially when you're pretty focused on tournament fishing.
All right.
I've got some baits hanging on the wall and around the room and stuff, but like these are the baits that I keep in the boat, which are, I've got a few Chads and Legends, a King, Negotiators, got a few Negotiators in there and a Mother. And basically it's just Negotiators and KGBs. That's the stuff that I bring with me if I'm going to throw them. And then I've got, you know, a soft bait box too, but that's about it. Keep it pretty simple.
Do the soft baits get worked into the arsenal sooner than the glides, or
about the same time?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you can throw either or all winter long if you want. You're gonna get less, you know, a few bites on it around here in the wintertime, but you could throw either or for sure. You can still catch a big fish on them.
Heck yeah. Okay, so was this the first Anglers in Action that you fished this year?
Yes. Yep. That was actually the first one of this season.
Okay. And let's see. You've got, so the next one that you've got is on Table Rock. Are they all around that area?
Yeah, they do. Lake of the Ozarks, Table Rock, and Grand. So they had Lake of the Ozarks on the 5th, and then last weekend they had Grand, and this weekend they have Table Rock. I think next weekend is off, and then the weekend after that, I think is back to Lake of the Ozarks, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. And is there like a AOI points race?
Yeah. Yeah. They've got a championship. I think in the Anglers in Action, I think it's top 30%. Yeah. I think they take your best three tournaments that you fished. You can fish like the open division, which you can just fish three of those tournaments in either on any of the lakes, or you can fish like a specific division. I'm not super dialed into that. I'm just fishing the open division. So I think they'll take our best three tournaments by points and top 30% go to the championship, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. And what is your goal in fishing this series? Is it to win events? Are you going for the AOI stuff?
Both. I mean, I'd like to obviously win events, but I'd like to fish a championship. That'd be cool. And then I'm doing the same thing with the Ozark Mountain Team Trail. I've fished it, and I've won one of those, and we've got sixth in one of those, but I've never fished enough of them to be able to get to the championship in either one of the series. So I'd like to fish the championships in both those series.
Okay. Well, it's pretty good start to the year. Are you saying that you in the, what is it? The Ozark Mountain Team Trail. Is that what that is?
Yeah.
You won one this year?
No, Joseph Montgomery and I won one. What is it? August 30th of 2020, we won one. And that was just fishing swim baits. I think that was probably one of the bigger tournaments, or one of the first big tournaments around us, won on a swim bait. And that kind of opened a lot of people's eyes to it.
And are those pretty large events as well?
Yeah, it's comparable to the Anglers in Action. All the local hammers are usually fishing those. It's usually 150 to 200 boats.
Something that I think of when I think of that part of the country as far as bass tournaments go, and I'm wondering if you have gotten into it, like the night tournaments.
A lot of guys love those around here, but it's not my deal. I don't fish them.
You just, why not?
Maybe I would like it if I did, but I don't know. I like to be able to see what I'm doing, and I don't like staying up until 4 a.m. So
yeah.
I'd rather get up early and fish all day. But, you know, in the summertime, you know, all the big boats get out and partiers and stuff like that. But I honestly don't mind fishing in those conditions because those big old boat wakes stir them up and they eat the crap out of a swim bait. So I don't mind fishing when it's boats all over the place. Doesn't bother me a ton. I'll go fish on Memorial Day, and usually I smack them on Memorial Day on Table Rock with all the boat wakes, and I get out there and throw glide bait on some of the big bluffs and flat points and stuff, and they eat really well. So I don't know. I just, don't night fish much. Mosquitoes and dark and can't see and staying up late and hitting stuff that you don't see, and not my deal.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the biggest thing for me, the bugs, that's a huge pain in the butt. Especially when you have all those lights, so you can try to, you know, they have all those lights so they can see their line and stuff. And I'm assuming you're attracting them.
Not my
And the staying up all night thing, I think would probably be the biggest though. Like I'm getting old. Like I can't ride in the car for a couple hours without passing out. So, staying up all night in the pitch black dark like that, I would definitely,
I don't want to sleepy. I don't want to work all day on Friday and then go fish until 2 a.m. and get home at 4 a.m. and then sleep all day Saturday. I'd rather just go to sleep and fish all day Saturday.
Yeah, I'm with you there. Jay says he would call a big box full of baits like that as 401k.
No, it ain't that bad. I mean, I've got a junk bait box that, you know, has 30 baits in it. That swim bait box might have 15 in it, and then, you know, it's not any more expensive than any other aspect of fishing. The baits cost more, but you need less of them. So it kind of levels out.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, how many of those are sitting at the bottom of Table Rock Lake?
Not many. Not many. I don't lose a lot of swim baits. Usually like maybe two, maybe one or two hard baits a year, maybe three. but not many. You don't lose a lot of them if you're checking your stuff frequently and you've got your system dialed. You'll cast one off every once in a while, but I don't lose a hard bait to a snag or anything like that. Like, you got, you know, that toothy fisherman lure retriever, and it'll get them back. And if I lose one, it's, you know, being lazy, not retying, or just making a sloppy cast and casting one off every once in a while, which happens, but not many. They usually get fished for a long time or fished until they're broken.
Yep. Heck yeah. Okay, so we talked about this just real briefly before we went live here. You said something about how you don't think you would ever go back to a kayak, or you said something like that.
I couldn't go back to only a kayak.
Yeah.
I would actually like to purchase another kayak and use it. There's a handful of bites that it's definitely a benefit over a bass boat. I would like to buy another one. I've got one still, but it's kind of beat to crap and pretty much done its duty and it's worn out, and I'd like to buy another one.
Okay. So there are some benefits there. Just being able to get into tighter quarters, maybe.
Yeah, tighter quarters, or being able to put it in spots you can't a bass boat, especially. A lot of times I'll go up and beach the kayak and fish completely, you know, without any presence, pretty much. I like doing that. And just fishing areas where you can't, you know, launch a bass boat, take a bass boat, whatever else. A lot of small rivers or just stuff like that. You know, typical reasons you'd fish a kayak over a bass boat.
Yeah.
But, you know, most of the fishing I do is on these bigger lakes, so spending most of my time in the bass boat.
Now, what about, like, because there are guys that have done the opposite in your area, like Chad Davison, for instance, you know, guys that have, you know, competed in the bass boat scene and completely hung it up and they're full-blown kayak, like, you know, you could probably stir some stuff up if you did that, I would imagine. Is like, what is it for you? You know, because there's some pretty big money out there to be made. Like, what is it about the bass boat tournament scene versus maybe the kayak tournament scene?
I don't know. I would say it's just, you know, a higher level, the highest level of you know, competitive fishing. But at the same time, that's not completely true, because, you know, kayak fishing, tournament fishing has gotten huge, and there's some super, super good anglers that fish it.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think that's just kind of the Ozarks scene, and it's just a big deal. I mean, every weekend, you know, during the right time of year, you can go fish a 100 to 200 boat tournament out here, and, you know, it pays out anywhere from $2,000 to $10,000 plus. And, you know, it's all the same, you know, not all the same guys, but the same, you know, local hammers that you can go compete against. And I like that. I like being able to, I don't know. I mean, you can do kind of the same stuff kayak fishing, but I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I get it. I guess maybe where I'm going with this, and maybe didn't realize it, like, what's next, right? So, I mean, fishing all these local tournaments, I mean, so I guess that you could see that as almost a natural progression as you want to become more competitive.
I would love to, you know, travel more. Obviously, anyone that knows anything about it, it just costs a ton and it takes up time. You can't work 5 days a week, 40 hours a week, and pay your bills and still have time to go do that kind of stuff. It's a big deal to go do all that stuff. I'd like to fish some of the Toyota events and maybe the opens or something would be really cool, but that's a few years from now probably. But I'd like to get to that point. That'd be fun. But, you know, I really just enjoy going down south to Texas or new places and just chasing big fish is what I truly love.
Just for fun.
Yeah. Just going to find the biggest fish I can around the nation. That's what I enjoy the most, even more than tournament fishing. But
yeah, that's cool.
A lot of time and a lot of money. But, you know, I'd also like to compete. Tournament fishing around the nation would be really cool.
Yeah. I think that you know, I with all the success you've had, I think if you could find a way to make it work, you know, I'm sure that's a realistic.
I think it's in the future somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Very cool. What was I going to say there? I kind of lost it, but okay. So let's say Table Rock Lake. What is it in the next week or two?
Well, I've got it. It's this coming Saturday.
Okay. So this coming Saturday, are we still fishing a jerkbait? What do you expect to be playing there?
We'll be fishing a jerkbait, a little single swimmer, a jig and wrap, a Damiki rig, maybe an A-rig a little bit. Might break out a glide bait, unlikely. Rock crawler, crankbait. Just typical Table Rock stuff, you know, nothing crazy.
Okay.
A lot of them bait still and out roaming or suspended, just moving up. And then there's a handful of good fish that are in brush piles and stuff. So just typical Table Rock fishing this time of year.
Okay. Fair enough. Let's see. Well, do you have anything coming up that you might want to talk about? Anything that you're doing with like sponsors?
I'll be at the Swim at Universe gathering deal on Fork. I'll be there, and I'm missing out on, let's see, they put the Big Bass Bash on Lake of the Ozarks, the BFL on Table Rock, and the Big Bass Tour on Table Rock all on the same weekend, which is the same weekend as the Lake Fork Gather. So I'm missing the three biggest tournaments of the year to go there. So
I don't know why. Just because you wanted to hang out with me.
Yeah, something like that.
Well, I'll be there.
I'll be there.
Yeah, so we'll have to get together. You'll have to show me how to catch a big swim bait fish on Lake Fork.
I've got a decent bit of experience out there. I'm no Lake Fork expert by any means, but I think we'll catch them. It'll be fun. It'll be fish caught.
We'll probably have to go stop by Edwin's place and get us some short ribs.
Yeah, hell yeah, I'm in.
Yeah, I think it'll be a pretty cool time. I've never been to one of the gatherings. Have you?
Yeah, I went to the first one in Virginia.
Did you?
Mm-hmm.
I wanna pick up some baits while I'm down there. I've got an order I need to put in, but I'm getting some baits from Edwin. I'm gonna try that new. Is he calling it? It's not a tiny tum. What is he calling it? The smaller one. Have you seen that one?
Yeah, I saw a video of it. I don't know what he's calling it.
I think he said it's like. It's like a 3.5 inches. It's, I mean, it's super tiny. And
might have shown these on the last video. I don't remember, but there's some of Edwin's very first baits. There's
okay.
A little choppy glide. Don't look like anything he's doing now. That's some of his first stuff. And then there's another big old beefy glide.
Yeah. See, I don't have any glides from Edwin. All I have from him are all wakes, all of them.
Yeah, these are let's see, I got these in person from him at his house about 2 years ago, right when he was starting to play with Macon.
That's cool. So were you down there fishing Fork?
No, Cole Anderson and I think we went down there to fish a little lake down there just for the weekend or something. We went and kayak fished a small lake and stopped by his house on the way back or something like that.
You went to Welsh?
No.
No? Okay.
No. That's out there. I go down there, and I know I can go smack them out there, but it doesn't pump out any big ones.
Yeah. That's kind of what he's told me is it's a good lake to go if you want to catch fish, but not really big.
Compared to lakes that I know, you're like, sure, maybe there's been some big ones cut, but you're not going to go catch even an 8-pounder out there.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, there's probably obviously a few in there, but it's not the lake to be at if you're looking for quality or big fish in general.
Yeah, sure.
So smack crap out of 4 or 5 pounders.
Yeah, heck yeah. Which, you know, Kansas guys are cool with that.
Everybody's cool with that. I just haven't done it.
Yeah, and that's not what you go to Texas for. Yeah, I get you.
I'd rather go find a bite where I can smack the crap out of 4 or 5 pounders and maybe catch 12 pounders. So. There
you go. Yep. Well, do you want to leave the folks with any like jerkbait tips, or was there anything that I know we kind of went over a lot of that, but like anything else that you can think of, maybe if like for me, for the guy that doesn't have confidence in a jerkbait, you know, what is something I can do to maybe?
I mean, something that's just, I don't fish a jerkbait any different than anyone else, I don't think. I don't do anything special with it, but I think what I do different is make sure you've got new hooks on it, make sure you've got new line, make sure all your hardware, your tackle is 100% good, because I think that's a huge deal. Fishing stock hooks on crap and letting them bend out and bending them back in, or letting points roll over and bending those back out, just replace them, make sure you got new stuff. I think that's a huge, huge deal. And that's what wins tournaments. So that's how you lose big fish and almost win tournaments.
That's where all those stories come from.
I think keep all you don't be cheap on your hardware and just put the good stuff on it. You're going to use a lot of it. And that's a really big deal for me, you know, before any big tournament and everything gets new hooks, everything gets new line. I think that's a big, big deal.
Now, there are some baits out there. People will tell you, you know, these hooks are good out of the package. Do you feel like that, or do all of them get?
Like mega bass hooks, I personally hate, but Spros, they come with Gamakatsus, which is what I change things out to.
Okay.
They come with regular Gamakatsu round bends. This has this has the G finesses on it, which I like over that, but sometimes they're a little bit harder to get. So, you know, it depends on what bait it is. Some of them do come with good hooks, like the Spros, but Mega Bass, I've never even made a cast with the stock hooks on there just because I hate them and I haven't even used them. But,
yeah.
You know, just
that, like, barb that's on the outside.
Yeah, barb, and they're funny shaped and they're thin and they look brittle, and I don't like them, but
they
some,
do, yeah.
Some people I'm sure do, but not me.
What about the Sixth Sense ones? Are you switching those out?
Yeah, you know, they seemed good, but yeah, I switched those out to Gamakatsus too. Yeah. I don't think they're terrible by any means. I think you could get away with fishing the stock hooks on those, but I'd rather just change them to the Gamakatsus and know what I have on there.
Yeah, confidence.
Yep.
Yeah, that's what I need to build up in the jerk bait. So I'm gonna try to do that. See if I can put me together a 23-pound sack.
Learn how to fish. When the biggest deal is, you know, twitch it on a slack line. Don't reel it up and move that bait when you're not meaning to. Just hit it real hard on a slack line and kind of bounce your rod tip off the recoil of the bait. You know, to where you're just bouncing it off the bait.
Yeah.
That's what gets bit for me.
Okay.
Is dropping the rod and letting it bounce back up, and that just gives that bait a real just sharp action. It's going from slack to popping it and then immediately back to slack. I think that's a big key work in a jerk bait, which not like anything special, but I think that's what gets bit for me. So
yeah, cool, man. Well, I appreciate that, and I'm definitely gonna pay maybe a little bit more attention to that, because I could be doing something totally wrong, but I appreciate you coming on here. I think it's awesome that as you're willing to come on here and talk fishing a little bit with me, and really happy with seeing you have some success out there on those big Ozarks lakes like you do, and definitely going to be cheering you on at this next event you got coming up. And hopefully we'll be able to link up in Texas.
I'll see you there.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. It'll be my first one ever. And
what is that? The 15th. So that's what, 30 days from today?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So I took the Friday and the Monday off. So you know, I don't have a ton of time, you know, but I may have the kids with me. I don't know that we have anybody to watch kids, so it may be a family affair, but
yep.
You know, hey, yeah, we'll go have some fun. We'll probably spend a little bit too much on big baits, and
perfect.
Hopefully we don't hit any stumps out there.
Ah, stay in the boat lanes, you'll be all right. Well, stay in the main boat lanes and trust those, but don't trust anything else.
Yeah.
Idle to the boat lane, you'll be all right.
All right, man. Well, appreciate you, and we'll see you here soon. You have a good evening, and go whack him at the next one, man.
Yes, sir. I appreciate you. Have a good night.
All right, you too.
Yeah.
All right, guys, there it is. Brennan Banks, just talking a little fishing tonight. You know, this thing is pretty unofficial, right? You know, this is, we call it a podcast, but we're really just kind of talking fishing. If you're interested in joining this conversation, make sure you tune in live. I'm going to be putting this out there as more of a listen on demand, you know, podcast. This is something that really right now, most episodes are only going to be available right here on YouTube. So there's a little bit of limitation if you want to listen. I know if you have like the YouTube Premium, you can actually, you know, turn your screen off and listen. But if you don't have YouTube Premium, you know, as soon as your screen goes to sleep, then, you know, you're not able to listen any longer. So there's some limitations with, you know, listening to this exclusively as a podcast. But let me know, because that is something I want a little bit of feedback on. I know the Spotify seems to be a big one, and we have made some of our episodes available on Spotify. If you haven't heard any of those, if you want a place to go listen to some of these podcasts, go to Spotify, search Behind the Reel Fishing, and you'll see those episodes. I probably have 10 or so of them up there. We'll continue to load them up there, and we'll probably find some other avenues to load them, like on Google, or I don't know. There's a bunch of different options for listening to podcasts. Let me know, where do you listen to your podcast? I would appreciate a comment down in the comment section below if you have a podcast source of choice. So, but yeah, again, Brennan is an absolute hammer. He's a hell of a dude. He is really well known for fishing big swim baits. A lot of guys, you know, as Edwin kind of joked earlier on about the Ned rig, you know, they know him as a big swim bait guy, but he is well versed. I think that going out to a lake like Lake of the Ozarks, that's not known to be an easy lake by any means. It's huge. You know, cold water deal. I mean, all of the things that he had working against him, plus the fact that this is not a body of water that he is super confident in. It doesn't sound like, he says maybe only fishes a couple times a year. You know, if he's able to go out there and do what he did, then that tells you something. But, you know, another thing too, that, you know, when people are asking him about these big swim baits, you know, this was not a big topic at hand today, but, he's got a lot of tournament wins and, a lot of money won off of a big swim bait. So, if you guys have any questions, he's a great wealth of knowledge as far as the swim baits go as well. So, guys, I do want to thank you for tuning in. If you haven't done so already, share this podcast with a group, share it with a buddy. We're just trying to get out there. We're trying to make more people aware of what we're doing. And I want to try to grow the podcast side of things. It seems like maybe having it on YouTube only, we're somewhat limited. So I've got a couple things that I'm going to start working on, but if you could help us grow a little bit and just share this, because I know every single one of you guys that is nerdy enough to listen to, you know, something like this. I mean, you know, we're just nerding out on fishing stuff. I know you've got some buddies that feel the same way. So do me a favor, share this. And hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. If you really want to show some support to the channel, go get you one of these hats. I will put that link down in the description below to the Shopify page, and you can get one shipped to your front door. Right now, we are doing free shipping on all of our merch. We have some shirts up there. So if you're interested, you can save on shipping, and would really appreciate that. That'll not only make us a few bucks, but also help spread the word. And plus, these hats are super comfortable. The shirts are super heavy duty as well. So you will be pleased. I'm going to go ahead, call this a night. I appreciate you guys, and we'll see you on the next one.